All right, I just got the tank back from the fabricator where they made adjustments to the hinge. The lid now closes. In this video, we're gonna take a look at all the features of the tank, and I think I have a functioning resin casting 10-gallon pressure tank that's good to go. Let's check it out.
My name is Eric Strebel. I'm an industrial designer. Welcome to my channel about product design and making. I hope that you like, enjoy, and become a subscriber. Here's a quick recap of building a 10-gallon pressure tank. Yes, there are several other videos in the series linked to the top. Drove to Indiana, bought a 10-gallon pressure pot, took it back to the shop, modified it, came up with a plan, had some hinges fabricated, and did not take into account casting a new gasket. Failed miserably at casting a gasket twice, and now I have a tank. The lid doesn't close. Obviously, that's not functional. We need to fix that. All right, so back to the fabricator, the tank went, and we made some modifications. They're just doing a little bit of grinding here so that they can re-weld the updated hinge back to the lid so we can have a little bit of adjustment and we can actually get the lid to close and function. Let's remount the tank back to the wall and review quick what adjustments we made on the hinge. So the hinge, we added like a link, so we would have some adjustability in that lid so I can actually close it, and should I ever need to make a different gasket or the gasket changes over time, it sticks a little bit, that needs to be adjusted too. So we have this double hinge system, basically like a link in a chain, and this is giving us just enough adjustability to close the lid. Works pretty decent, and I'm happy with that. Let's reassemble the tank. We got two 700-watt drum barrel heater strips, and this is what is going to allow my tank to be heated. So they attach pretty simply here. They have some spring clips that hold the heater strips onto the tank. These were custom made, and you can watch a little and learn a little bit more about that in some of the previous videos. So I got them on eBay from a Chinese manufacturer, told them the diameter of the tank, and they made these for me. They get quite warm, which I'm very happy about. So really good for preheating your molds and then of course curing your resin. So post curing the resin once you've poured it into the molds as well. So that's super, super handy. I like to have, you know, nice meaty knobs when I'm gonna grab onto something and hold them and rotate them a little bit, you know, just feels good in your hands. So let's make some for the tank. And I actually have a video on that as well. So I got some orange PLA and I printed out top and bottom covers to go onto the existing thumb screws. And we're gonna resin fill those so that you can easily just grip onto them with your hand and rotate them closed, because time is of the essence when you are resin casting and you need to get that lid closed quickly sometimes and get it under pressure. So I print out the knobs in two pieces, six of them of course, and I drill a little hole here, and this is where the resin is going to get injected into the knob once those thumb screws are attached and we put them together. So these are what the thumb through screws look like. Gee, I can't talk today in this video, so good, so just bear with me. Anyway, once we take them out, we will put them on the inside of these knobs, the shells, and we're going to super glue them together so that we can resin fill them. Let's do that. They need to be clamped together while the super glue sets up. There's a little bit of distortion caused by the knob, the wing nuts itself onto the knobs. And so I anticipate that they're gonna leak a little bit. Thus I have my paper underneath here. It's actually a parchment paper. Works really good. Resin doesn't stick to it. It's wax coated. And yeah, of course they leak a little bit, and we'll let them cure. And before the resin cures all the way, I can peel it easily off of the knobs and then come back with a second round to top them off and fill them solid. And that's why I use the orange resin. So now, one of the cool things that I've done on my tank is I've added a temperature sensor, remote temperature sensor, so I can monitor the temperature on the inside of the tank. And I've purchased a little weather station here. It's includes a rain meter, but we don't need that. And this thing goes up to 160 degrees, and or says it goes up to 160 degrees, and allow me to monitor the temperature on the inside of the tank. So let's cut away the parts, the plastic parts that we don't need, so that we can mount this temperature sensor on the inside of the tank and monitor and be able to correctly set the temperature from the heater strips. So I'm just cutting off the pieces on the bandsaw to get it just the absolute minimum shape so I can put it inside the tank. I'm going to use some two-part epoxy putty, and I'm just going to cut off a piece and then mix it, knead it together, and then glue it or mount it on the inside of the tank lid. That's going to be the easiest place that'll allow me to access the batteries, that sort of thing. I like using this kind of epoxy for this kind of stuff to just stick dissimilar materials together. Works pretty good, sets up pretty quick. You knead the stuff together, it's like a two-part epoxy. And then you just stick it on whatever it is you want to stick it on, and probably sets up in, well, 5 minutes, something like that, 10 minutes. It gets pretty stiff pretty quick. Now, we're going to mount the sensor on the inside of the tank, and it all seems like a really good idea. But what ends up happening is the battery or the power source is on the inside of the tank, which I don't really think is really the way to go. And I think in the future, having some pass-through electrical connectors on the lid of the tank is something that I'm going to want to do, so that I can have the power source on the outside of the tank and not damage my batteries either from pressure and or heat. And here you can see the temperature on the inside. I'll show that a little bit more when we actually cast something up. So let's do that. Let's test out the tank and cast something up to test it and see how it works. I'm gonna mix up some resin, put in a little bit of dye here, and make a red part for something that I happen to be casting at the moment. We'll vacuum degas that, and we're gonna pour it into these two-part silicone molds that I got right here. We'll pour the resin in, and then I'll show you the resin filling up. You can kind of see it rising to the top in this time-lapse video right here. The resin goes down on the left and fills the cavity from the bottom. I have a little overflow reservoir here at the top, so I know that the cavity has been filled. Let's put that mold inside the pressure tank. So the beauty of this whole system, of course, is you can just slide your molds in, and there's plenty of room on the inside there for multiple molds, and we can rotate those knobs easily shut and close the lid very quickly. The other thing too about these knobs is that you can easily do this one-handed and get them quite tight. It's very ergonomic, easy to do, and for people that have a little bit less strength in their hands, if you're a female, this would be a great way to go to really get a good secure fit, tight seal on your lid. Let's hook up the air and let that air into the tank so we can pressurize the resin that's curing inside the tank. We're at 131 degrees F and we're about 60 PSI. This gauge is not super accurate. It's the gauge that came with the tank. It's something that probably needs to be upgraded at the moment or in the future. And you can see here connected to my air compressor. Also got a video of that in case you haven't seen that. Build your own air compressor. Once the resin is cured, we can disconnect the tank and we can let the air out here through the silencer. It's really not very loud. I have a video on that as well, how to build a pressure tank silencer so you can stay safe, because it is quite loud when you're releasing that volume of air out of a pressure tank and you want to stay safe. So once all the air is out, easy again to undo the knobs since they're so easy to grab onto. Just a really nice feature to have. They feel really good in your hands too. Let's take that out of the tank and see how our part came out. All right, this is what I would call a gravity mold. You can see the sprue and the runner. The resin goes through the gate at the bottom of the part, fills up the part, and then comes out the little runners at the top into the overflow area. And you get a really nice part this way with minimal amount of cleanup. And it's a pressure cast part, so there should not be any bubbles inside of this part. You get a nice clean part. You just snap this stuff off here and that's just waste. So, you know, it looks like a little plastic model part because basically that's what it is. All right, I want to cast up one more part for you, and this part is a little bit more translucent. I did add some colorant to it so that you could see the form a little bit, but I used a clear casting resin so that you could see through the part and see how nice of a part it actually is once it's been cast or pressure cast. Under pressure inside the tank, and you basically cannot do clear resin parts without a good pressure tank. You just can't get rid of those bubbles. I mean, you might get lucky or whatever, but not on a consistent basis. So I did have to inject this clear resin in there. It set up pretty quick on me, and you can actually see in the parts sort of the second injection in there, and there's actually some crap in the parts, but it's a pretty nice part, and I'm pretty happy with that part. So pretty decent for a clear part. Very happy with the new tank. The main reason I built this bigger tank is so I could cast bigger parts, things like headlights, tail lights for vehicles. If you have any projects like that, I would love to quote them for you. I'd still like to add some pass-through electronics so I can get power on the inside remotely to power rotary devices on the inside and to power the temperature sensor. Make sure you give the video a thumbs up and don't forget to subscribe if you haven't already done so. Hey, and don't forget to follow me on social media. I'm on Facebook sometimes, Twitter usually, and now Instagram. Rock on. Click here to check out some of the other design and making videos that I have that you might enjoy.